we had talked about the security angle here, and Famita, you were talking. We were talking earlier that one of the things you wanted to get into was what's going on security-wise right now. So take it away. What's going on?
Well, I mean, I like the fact that Brandon was talking very diplomatically about how there are many reasons people don't want to go to the cloud. But I think it's fair to say that for most enterprises, the primary reason, or if not one of the top three, is security. They're so worried about all this data that they're collecting, that they're using, and then putting it up on cloud, which is, by definition, open. And when you look at the news, you have Verizon customer data being leaked, Dow Jones, you have the voting record. It just seems like it is, unfortunately, the case that you put data on the cloud, it's going to get breached. And I want to actually kind of point out that this is a misperception that once you put it up there, it's the cloud provider's job to do all the securing. You know, if you have your own data behind a firewall during your perimeter, the IT department, the security team works together, figures out how to protect the data. And that responsibility doesn't go away when you move to the cloud providers. And that's been something that I think got lost somewhere in the shuffle, where it's like, oh yeah, I gave it to Amazon. It's there. Amazon is taking care of it. They're hack-proof. I'm safe. And that's really not the case.
No, that doesn't sound like a good way to look at things. It's too dangerous.
Exactly. I think you're right. I think so many people have been enamored with the idea of public cloud and, oh, I can just use Amazon's cloud and I'll be safe and secure. But if you talk to Amazon, they talk about this shared security model. And we do our own thing to protect our data centers and provide base level infrastructure security. But there's still stuff that you have to do, Mr. Customer, to secure your cloud. And there's a right way to do it, and there's a wrong way to do it.
Exactly. And I mean, that's exactly it. The shared responsibility model is basically Amazon take care of the infrastructure, the actual servers, but the virtual machine that you're spinning up, the application you're installing, the data storage itself, whether or not you use encryption or not, that is entirely up to the enterprise. And until IT administrators, or even, I mean, the other thing about the cloud is you don't have to wait for IT. Developers, other business admins, they can spin it up as well. And if they aren't actually realizing that, hey, I shouldn't check off global access on my server because that means anyone in the world can access the server. And unfortunately, that's exactly what's happening. I mean, with Dow Jones and Verizon, they actually had checked off, make it globally accessible. It sounds easy. Oh, I can access it from any IP address. But it means anyone who had the time to sit down and type out random IP addresses or try to guess the URL also finds the password, also finds the server instance. So one thing that we really need to start talking more about is just the fact that Amazon, and I'm picking on Amazon a little bit, but the same thing with Microsoft Azure, Google Cloud, they provide the tools. They provide services for enterprises to do the security management. And that needs to be something that each enterprise is taking into account. That I do need to make sure that if I have data being stored, if it's customer data, if it's PII, I need to have encryption on there. I can't just say putting on S3 is sufficient. I need to make sure it's encrypted.
Do you think companies, I mean, it sounds like this to me seems like common sense. So how is it that these companies are checking off, you know, global access without realizing that they're potentially opening the door here to who knows who getting to that customer data? How do they not know that?
I think it's a combination of thinking, oh, who's going to come after me, who no one is interested in my data.
Right, okay.
And also just not really realizing what each of those options really mean.
Okay. And it also could be a factor of people are maybe moving a little too fast into this stuff. And like you said, there are developers who are going out and using VMs and spinning them up and maybe not doing that in an IT-sanctioned way and not being done in, you know, the most appropriate way. And yeah, I think you're right that there's a lot of sort of education that needs to be done and sharing of best practices of what is the right way to use the cloud. And sort of this sort of reinforce this idea that you do have to, you know, do stuff to use the cloud appropriately.
I mean, one of the things that was really interesting earlier in the year when all the NoSQL databases in the cloud started getting infected with ransomware, the biggest wake-up call for that was actually scientists who use the cloud for their data science and data analytics. They're not used to the fact that you have to think about security of their infrastructure. In traditional times, it was the university IT that took care of it, right. But the cloud was great. They're suddenly getting all these resources. So you have all these scientists who have gone ahead and said, oh yeah, I have to do this analysis. I'm just gonna put it up on Amazon. And then earlier this year, you had ransomware going through and suddenly locking up their entire career's work. And it was definitely when people got nattering on this side about security and encryption, I should be paying attention, or I should be talking to the security folks. And this is actually the opportunity for security folks to really start interjecting. You know, if they know that their enterprise is going to be looking at Azure Stack, they should be interjecting, saying, hey, let's make sure that we're talking about this. Let's make sure we're getting in. So it's actually a two-way street where the IT, the developers, everyone who's like, oh, I'm going to use the cloud, let me check in with my team to make sure I'm doing it right. But also for the security side to really start making a proactive effort to say, I know you're looking into this new thing. Let me work with you on it. Oh, you're thinking about the private cloud or hybrid. Let me make sure that we are actually on the right page. So it's a more of a conversation that needs to be happening, as well as education.
It's surprising how, you know, that conversation is the same conversation that IT has been trying to have with all of its users for the last 20 years. And even though we've moved to the cloud, that conversation never seems to really take place.
And it's we're not just talking about, you know, businesses that don't think they're going to be attacked. I mean, Verizon, Yahoo, TJX, Target. I mean, this happens on a monthly basis, and we find out about it 6, 7, 8 months down the line when our even if we change our password, it doesn't matter. Somebody has our data already. And it's from a consumer standpoint, it seems crazy that these end-to-end encryption, I encrypt my own account, and I'm one person. If I was handling millions of accounts with passwords and names and social security, I don't understand how somebody at that company didn't say, yeah, we need to encrypt this with the highest level of encryption that we possibly have.
As opposed to global access. Everyone can have access to it.
Now, not to totally defend the cloud and be a cloud homer.
Go ahead, Mr. Cloud. You are Mr. Cloud. Go for it.
This can happen if companies aren't using the cloud, too.
Correct.
Right?
True.
I mean, internal data centers can get hacked.
This is not really a cloud issue, per se. Right. It's a security issue.
Right.
It's that security conversation, whether you're public cloud, hybrid cloud, you know, no cloud at all, mm-hmm. you've still got people who are not making smart decisions when it comes to security. And it does baffle me as to why that conversation just either it doesn't sink in, or you've just got people who don't think about it or don't want to think about it or what, but it just never seems to happen in a way that we can shut down these breaches.
I mean, I think there are two things here. One is kind of referring back, like, I don't think people realize until maybe even the past year just how valuable some of the stuff that we keep online, some of the stuff we keep on our devices really are. You know, I hear a lot of people even now saying, oh, what are people going to do with my email address? And I'm saying, you have no idea what people can do with your email address. Like, don't be so cavalier about that. And I think it's just still people say, I'm a nobody. I'm just a small company. I'm just one person. I don't matter enough, you know. I think because we emphasize so much the nation state side of the attack, we forget that just normal corporate day-to-day data, personal data, is valuable, extremely lucrative to be mm-hmm. resold. So that's one. And I think the second one really also is we kind of, in technology, we don't have a lot of patience for mistakes, but mistakes happen. It's not that people don't care, but it's, as Brendan mentioned, if you're in a rush because you have to spin up so many servers and you're like, okay, let me get this up, I'll go back and change the password. And then something else happened and you got distracted and you forgot to change the password. It's not that you don't care, you meant to do it, but all of us have so many things going on competing for our time and attention that It just happened. I mean, that's what happened with the Verizon one. Everyone's sitting here beating up on this poor guy, saying, how can you be so dumb? But it really probably had more to do with he had a gazillion other things going on, and he just didn't get around to it.
There is truth to that. I mean, you know, we have to factor in the human equation, mm-hmm. and people are going to make mistakes, and it's just, and like, it seems to be the same mistake.
And then, I mean, that happens with us too. I mean, yeah. we write about this stuff, and I don't change my password every month like I'm supposed to, and all my accounts don't have two-factor authentication on it. I mean, it's, you get busy, you forget, and you know, it happens.
Yeah. Okay, well, so bottom line, we all should be changing our passwords right now, right?
And maybe there's a role here for advanced technology like machine learning to help help protect us better. I mean, Amazon talks about these platforms that they have that will automatically scan users, sort of what policies they have in place on their accounts, and they will tell you, hey, this traffic is not encrypted mm-hmm. that you're using in the cloud, and that's an automated platform. And so, I mean, I think there are things that can be done to sort of help people out, to point out bad behavior.
Well, and you do have to assume, too, that when these breaches take place, you know, the mythical person that we're beating up on, I'm sure he or she learned a lesson and will not make that mistake again if he or she is still employed somewhere, you know. And so I do think that, you know, gradually we do, I'm hopeful that we're making progress along these lines, but... it just, you know, every month it just seems like there's another breach.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, Ken, this is where exactly robots and automation are going to help, right?
I'm not sure Skynet's going to take care of us, you know? I'm a little worried about that, too. But no, I get it. No, I totally understand the machine learning part and the AI part that can suss out the things we may have missed. You know, I do understand that that's true.
I mean, one of the things that we talk about on the enterprise security side is a lot of these spinning up and configuration, if all that is automated, then you know it's always being done consistently, and that automation script is less likely to be distracted by a crisis. So I think that is one of the things that's going to change the conversation. As you mentioned, we've been trying to have this conversation for 20 years now. And I think that now that automation technology has gotten to the point where it's easier to use, it's a little bit more reliable, we're going to see that conversation happening, and with a better result.